So let us rejoice and be glad in
it. Yes, hallelujah.
Apologies, you can hear me. We have no mics, no musician, or anything.
Amen.
That doesn't stop us. We must go on.
Amen.
So, bow with me in a word of prayer. Precious Lord and Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and praise you for this day. We thank you for just touching us with your finger of love. Waking us up this morning, starting us on our way.
Yes.
Giving us use and action of our limbs, blood, warm, warming our veins. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you and we glorify you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for looking on the sick and afflicted.
Yes.
Looking at the shut in. Looking in the hospital wards, the prison wards. Heavenly Father, looking after the homeless, those without a home.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, that it's not us, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, thank you for looking on our children, being a fence around them, protect, keep them. Heavenly Father, I pray that you guide them to your saving grace, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we thank you for looking on the head of our country, Heavenly Father. In the decision that is made, Heavenly Father, let it be to glorify your name, Heavenly Father, and for our good, Heavenly Father. We thank you and we praise you. Heavenly Father, most of all, we thank you for looking on those that do not know you as Lord and Savior in their life. Giving them one more opportunity, Heavenly Father. You didn't shut the door yet. They still have an opportunity to come into your saving grace before it's too late. Heavenly Father, we thank you for that. Heavenly Father, thank you for looking on all our families, looking at our homes, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, just continue to bless us as we go forth, go and come, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, we recognize you as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We acknowledge you, and we know that our very existence would not be without you. So, Heavenly Father, we just want to glorify your name today. We want to thank you. We want to praise you. We want to lift you up. We want to glorify you, Heavenly Father. So please be pleased with our praise. Heavenly Father, we thank you. As we go into the service today, we thank you once again for the preaching opportunity. You said your word would not return void, Heavenly Father. So let the words that are said today, Heavenly Father, touch someone's heart, mind, body, and soul, Heavenly Father. That would be for the good. Maybe they could share it with someone else. Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord once again.
Hallelujah.
Today I would like to speak to you from 1 Corinthians.
Yes, sir.
Chapter 12. So while you're turning there, I always like to share a little something with you. There was a man, he comes home from work, his wife's sitting there with his arms folded. And she said, you know what day it is, right? He said, of course I know what day it is. It's our anniversary. He said, so what did you give me for anniversary? He said, I bought you something nice, it's beautiful, you would love it. So she said, well, what is it? He said, I'm telling you, we'll love it. He says, well, so what is it then? She said, it's a burial block.
Oh,
he says, wait a minute. He says, it's beautiful. It's always manicured beautifully. Everybody loves it. It's one of the best you can get. So fast forward a year later, she comes home again. The man comes home again and says to his wife, she says to him, you know what day it is? He said, yes, it's our anniversary. She said, what did you give me? He said, what did I give you? You didn't use the one I gave you last year.
All right, preacher.
So, in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 1 through 11, reads, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant. You know that when you were Gentiles, you were led away unto dumb idols, howsoever ye might believe. Wherefore, I make known unto you that no man speaketh in the spirit of God and saith, Jesus is Anathema. Or a curse, that's what it means. And no man can say, Jesus is Lord, but he is in the Spirit. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are diversities of ministration, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of works, but the same God, who works all things in all. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Spirit to profit with all. For the one is given through the Spirit the word of wisdom, another the word of knowledge, another according to the same Spirit, and another faith in the same Spirit, and another gift of healing in the same one Spirit, and another working miracles, and to another prophecy, and to another discerning the spirits, and to another diverse kinds of tongues, and to another interpretation of tongues. But all these works in one and the same Spirit, dividing to each one severally, even as he will. Please bow with me in a word of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you again. We thank you for this preaching opportunity. Heavenly Father, we ask that your word go forth, Heavenly Father. Touch every heart, Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father, I pray that you take control, that you speak through me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Here in 1 Corinthians, Paul's letter to the church of Corinth, he addressed some issues with the churches, and he addressed a lot of different issues coming up to this particular one. And this is one about spiritual gifts. He addressed sexual immorality, adultery, a whole bunch of other. Today, I'd like to focus on the spiritual gifts. So how many of us here know what our spiritual gift is? You know, you do have a spiritual gift. No matter who you are, you do have a spiritual gift given to you by God. All right, three things I would like to do today. I would like for you to discover your spiritual gift. I would like for you to develop your spiritual gift. And also exercise your spiritual gift. Spiritual gifts, what is it? Spiritual gifts are God-given abilities. He equips us all to serve effectively. And yet many people in the church today still fail to understand and embrace exactly what it is he has provided for us. Our spiritual gifts are specifically chosen for each one of us by God. Mm-hmm. So he touches each and every one at the moment of salvation. He gives us all a spiritual gift, some even more. He said, and talents he tells us according to our abilities. Let me speak. Our spiritual gifts are specially chosen for us by God and for the good, and for our good, and for the good of the church. Get that? It's for our good, mm-hmm. and for the good of the church.
Amen.
The Lord wants all of us to serve his kingdom, mm-hmm. in some manner or another. Mm-hmm. Not just because there's work to be done, mm-hmm. but because serving draws us closer to him. When we serve the Lord and we use our spiritual gift, it draws us closer to the Lord.
Amen.
How many make resolutions at the end of the year, at the beginning of the year? I want to be closer to the Lord this year. Use your spiritual gifts. Learn about his word. Mm-hmm. See, he provides us with everything we need.
Amen.
So it's our responsibility to discover our spiritual gifts and to develop them and exercise them with the help of the Holy Spirit. We can't do it without the help of the Holy Spirit. Paul in Corinthians said, now concerning the spiritual gifts, I do not want you to be ignorant or unaware. See, God isn't trying to hide these gifts from us. Matter of fact, on the contrary, he wants us to know them and to use them. And he wants to show us also how to use these gifts.
Amen.
If you remember, I read, he says that the people were led astray. And he said, however, you were led. So that means someone was teaching them wrong. Mm-hmm. Paul wanted to set it straight when he wrote the letter to the church of Corinth. Oh, he wanted to make sure that everybody knew what was right.
Amen.
Although they're different in many ways, all of them come from the Spirit. To discover our spiritual gift, we should examine how we respond to situations or needs.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of dwelling on what we should do for how others are served.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you respond to a situation, to an emergency, to a crisis? Think about how you respond to it. And I think your spiritual gifts should be mm-hmm. close to how you respond to a situation. If you jump right in and help, then, you know, of course, then you're a helper, you know.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
If you run away, we must focus on what motivates us. And I ask you in your heart, what motivates you? Thinking of spiritual gifts. What things motivate you? For example, if you love to study the Word and share with others the things that you study, then maybe, just maybe, your gift may be in teaching. If you love to help others and show compassion to others, that might indicate that you have the gift of serving or mercy and so forth. So after we discover our spiritual gifts, we find out what our spiritual gifts are,
mm-hmm.
then we must develop our spiritual gifts. The next step is to cultivate them. And although they were given to us at the moment of salvation, they do not come fully developed. Think about it. When you're born, you're a babe, you know, you don't come fully developed. It takes time.
Mm-hmm.
You grow, you know, and same with, you know, in the Word and your spiritual gift. You develop them and help them to grow through practice. Everybody hear me? Practice. Practice is very important. We learn to employ them. Through practice, we learn to employ them. It's similar to the development of a talent. Someone may have a natural musical ability, but if you never receive instructions from a qualified teacher or make any attempt to play an instrument, that talent will lie dormant. However, since these are divinely given abilities and not natural ones, they must be empowered by the Spirit in order to be effective. So we pray to God and ask God what He wants for us. You know, how He wants us to use our gifts. And He will tell us there are through the Spirit. They must be empowered by the Holy Spirit in order to be effective. Self-effort results in strain, exhaustion, and fruitlessness. But when we walk in the Spirit and yield to the obedience of God, He makes our efforts successful. Have you ever been to a point where you're trying things, you're trying to do things, and it's just not working? Just not working, no matter how hard you try. But then once you pray to the Lord, ask the Lord to do it, it becomes a simple thing. It becomes a lot easier, you know, through help from someone else. But he makes a way once you ask him and talk to him. We can't effectively use our spiritual gifts in our own strength any more than we can manufacture God's love. See, the mistake that we often make is thinking that spiritual gifts are doing things. But in reality, first it requires us to abide in Christ and walk in the Spirit. So how many of us know what abiding means? If you remember John, when Jesus went away, he said he would send a comforter, and that comforter would abide in us. So it was indwelled. Thank you. It stays for a long time. In other words, it doesn't come and go. It's set up residence. So in your spiritual gifts, you got to let the Holy Spirit abide in you. We must be willing to say to God, I won't get in the way of you doing with and in me whatever you choose to do. Lots of times, the Lord is trying to work in our life, and we kind of want to help him out. Anybody do that? It ain't happening fast enough. So I want to try to help you out.
Amen.
The Lord don't need our help.
Mm-mm.
He is all-knowing, all-powerful, and he's everywhere. He's sovereign. He can do what he wants, when he wants, and however he wants to do it. So we sometimes just need to stay out the way and be patient, wait for the Lord to work this thing out. Once we've asked him, we can thank him for it daily. Thank you for what you do. He says, if we ask, see, he's faithful and just to give us these things that we ask, as long as we are abiding in him and we ask for the right reason. So sometimes we ask for the wrong reason. So long as we abide in him and ask for the right reason, he says, I'll gladly give it to you. He also tells us that, you know, if we delight ourselves in him, that means enjoy serving him and enjoy it. Not just make it a work thing. He said he will give us the desire of our heart if we delight ourselves in him.
Amen.
We must ask the Lord to remove anything that's displeasing and produce in me whatever I am lacking. Sometimes there are things that are displeasing in our life that we don't want to get rid of. We like them. So we won't ask the Lord to get rid of it.
Mm-hmm.
But we must just be submit to him and ask him to remove it. Lord, I surrender. I surrender all. After we discover our spiritual gifts, and after we develop our spiritual gifts, we must exercise our spiritual gifts. Once we have discovered the gifts and have begun to develop them through training and practice and submission to the Spirit, we are ready to put them to use. Peter says in 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Very important. We must be good stewards with our gifts, not be abusive to them. We must know how to manage those gifts that God has given us. Right? So no matter how little we have to offer, see some things, and sometimes we may say, oh, this is what I have ain't important. It's only a small thing. Maybe it's, you know, sweeping the floor or cleaning the bathroom or making a program. It ain't a big thing. Who would even care if they didn't get done? Life still goes on. But even those things are important. If nobody took care of the bathroom, it would be filthy. Nobody wanted to use it. If nobody swept the floor, it would become a, you know, pigsty. It would become a mess. So no matter how little you may think that your gift is, you must make it available for God.
Amen.
God wants to make ourselves available for His service. We won't realize our potential until we act. Once we put these things into action, then we start to realize the potential that we have. Therefore, we should never underestimate what God can do. Through us. The way He can use us. After we discover our spiritual gifts, after we develop our spiritual gifts, after we put them to action, there's one more thing that's very important. There's one more element that's essential for the effective exercise of our gifts. Sandwiched between chapter 2 and 1 about spiritual gifts, Paul writes the importance of love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, 1-3 says, 1-3 says, no matter how great our gifts are, or how proficient our gifts are and how we use them, if we do not do them in love, they are ineffective and profit us none. Love is an important key in exercising our spiritual gift. Without love for those that we serve, all our works will be burned up in God's judgment, like wood, hay, and straw. Spiritual gifts require abiding in Christ and walking in His Spirit. Although that seems like an impossible standard, we must remember that spiritual gifts are divinely empowered and motivated. We can't manufacture God's love any more than we can effectively use our spiritual gift in our own strength. But when we walk in the Spirit, Jesus lives His life through us. But it requires us to do something. As much as possible, walk in the Spirit and draw closer to Him. So in the conclusion of my sermon for today, we must not just only appreciate our spiritual gifts that God has given us, but we must appreciate others' gifts. It's important that we recognize others' gifts and appreciate those gifts that God has given others. Jesus the Christ is the full expression of all the spiritual gifts, because He alone is the God-man who lived a perfect life. After ascending to the Father, He entrusted the church with the task of carrying out His work here on earth.
Yes.
To accomplish this, He gave a variety of spiritual gifts to His followers, who are now His body. See, Christ is the head, and He is the one who fits it together to form a well-functioning body that grows and builds itself up in love. Remember, the love is very important. When all of these are operating according to the gifts or the gifting Together, we become what we long to be, a New Testament church.
Amen.
See, it's not enough to discover, develop, and exercise our own gifts. We must also value other people. No one sees the entire picture. No one has all the answers.
Come on.
We need each other to point out our blind spots. The light of our blind spots. No matter how we look, we can't see. We need others to teach us humility. You know, sometimes when our gifts are great, we become proud or boastful. We need others to teach us humility, be humble in our gifts. And handling matters that we can't tackle alone. We need others to support. There's some things you just can't do by yourself. So we need other people. We need to come together with other people so other people can help us. We help them, and they help us. God uses our difference to shape us into precious image, so we can display the fruit of the Spirit. We each have a job to do in the church. Every one of us have a job to do, and we all blessed with a gift. Therefore, let's be good stewards of our gifts. In the power of love and the Spirit, so that one day we will hear our Father say, "Well done, my good and faithful
servant."
Amen. Yes, church, we have
to
touch with special gifts. We have to discover what our gifts are.
Yes, yes.
We must develop those gifts, and we must exercise those gifts in love in order to be effective in the service of our God. God bless you. It's always proper to open up the doors of the church to anyone that may not know Jesus as Lord and Savior in their life. Anyone that may need prayer, or anybody want to draw closer to you. The door, Father God, we thank you and praise you for all that was said and done today, Heavenly Father. We thank you for all that the sit attentive, listen and receive your word. And Father, hide it deep in their heart that when they need your word, Heavenly Father, you will bring it back to him. And Father, we ask you to touch each and every one. Bless our homes, our surroundings, the outgoings, our incoming. Bless the things they have to touch. Heavenly Father, let them see Christ. Let God see Christ through each and every one of them, us, as we go about our day. And Heavenly Father, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name forever. We forever will be praised. Amen.
Amen.
Now, sir, it changes things, church. It really does. So it's important that you mention someone's name in prayer. Just pick one or two, those that you know.
Love Amen.
Them. Pick their names off the list and pray for them individually. And now for the benediction. Now to him that's able to keep us from falling, to present us faultless before his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.